You are so good to me. You heal my broken heart. You are my Father in heaven. You are so good to me. You heal my broken heart. You are my Father in heaven. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. I will sing again. You ride upon the clouds. You heal me to the truth. You are the Spirit inside me, yes, Lord. You ride upon the clouds. You lead me to the truth. You are the Spirit inside me. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. I will sing again. You died upon the cross. You are my Jesus who loves me. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. I will sing again.
How about just the voices? You are beautiful.
You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. I will sing again.
Praise you, Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I will worship your holy name.
Come on.
The sun comes up, there's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. I will worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I will worship your holy name. And on that day, when my strength is
Here's a song to prepare your hearts for the message we're focusing on today, that special person that God knew about, Mary, the mother of Jesus. And just put your ladies, put yourself in that position, what it would have been like. Many, many women were wondering, they thought the Messiah was coming close, and they thought, could it be me? They were wondering. Now, gentlemen, put yourself in the place of Joseph. Joseph is said to be a just man. And that means that he was giving her the benefit of the doubt, because I guarantee he was doubting at first. The angel came and made all things right. So as we sing this song, just focus on that couple and how they were a couple that God chose for a very purpose, to bring our Savior into this world.
Your baby boy would save our sons and daughters. Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you've delivered will now deliver. His hand.
Change a key. That's what happens when you put a cape on, you forget to take it off. So we'll go here. Of course, I don't have a bass player up here today, so it would have been just fine. But if we got Cliff on the trumpet, that would have messed you up. Here we go.
Oh, holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till He appeared and the soul
Thank you for sending Jesus. Lord, thank you for becoming one of us to show us how it's done. Lord, you are worthy. Worthy is the Lamb. And we just bless your heart today, Lord. And I ask that you would be with our hearts and ears as we listen to Brother Zach as he comes up and just talks about it. We give you the praise and the glory. Everybody said.
Good to be in the house of the Lord, amen? Oh, just something about worshiping with the body. It's something we don't always get a chance to do because we're not here 24/7. We have jobs, we have homes, we have families. And there's a lot to do there, amen? Yes, Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Well, I have to stand before you somewhat wounded, but nevertheless fine. I had some hand surgery done, so if you see me favoring my arm, it's no big deal. It's just had some trigger finger relief here, so getting much better. Well, I wanted to start off with this morning. I know Uncle George prayed here. We call him Uncle George in our family because our kids pretty much grew up together. But what's really neat is that you do feel the love and the mercy that that this family has to offer. And I do see it as our family. So let's just pray one more time. Father God, I just pray right now. Just come before you with a humble spirit. My heart and mind wants to just be submitted to you, God. I pray that I don't speak from my words. Pray that I could share some of the insights that you gave me, Lord. And I pray that they would be helpful and meaningful to what's needed in this body today, and I thank you for it, and I pray your blessings on this time in Jesus' name, amen. So Pastor Craig had asked me to round out the series of gift giving, and he kind of recapped a little bit last week, and I thought I'd do the same. Again, the first gift we had was love, the gift of love. That's the love that sent Jesus into this world, amen? That's a pretty powerful thing. Kind of getting some feedback here, I don't know if that, okay. The love of the Bible is not an emotional love, remember that? It's one that we choose to love, and that is really the true gift of Christmas, the love of Christmas that we choose to give. The second gift was waiting, and Pastor Craig used an example of Anna and Simeon. They were praying and waiting on the Lord, and we were encouraged to stay positioned, that we not grow weary, because if we'd had, Simeon would have missed the blessing. We continue to worship, we can continue to trust, we continue to have faith as we reach out to God when we're praying, right? So when he says it's time to move, we're ready. We can move, right? And the third gift was the gift of attitude, the right attitude. Pastor Craig asked, how are we doing? How's your attitude for Christmas? You know, are you guys ready? Are you ready for Christmas? But it's something more than just our activities. Are we trusting the Lord? Are we trusting the Lord with all of our heart? And we make sure to lean not on our own understanding, but we're leaning on him. We care about other people and the unconditional love that's exampled by Christ. We give what we have, but most importantly, we give ourselves for Christmas. And hopefully that's not just one time a year. Hopefully it's all year round that we would spend our lives in a giving nature. It really is about the blessings that we can give. Not that we grow haughty in what we do, because it's not about works. But as Christians, as we press into God, the love compels us to be giving. At least I would hope so. And there's more to giving than just monetary, the physical time. It's our hearts, our minds. If we really commit to one another as our family, we're here for each other, and I hope that we can be. So that brings us to the fourth gift, and Craig had asked me to speak on Mary and the Lamb. So the first thing that I thought of was look up was Mary had a little lamb, but I quickly realized that's probably not what he was angling on. But if we think about it, Mary did give the perfect lamb, if you will, to play on the phrase a little bit, because John recognized it in chapter 1 and saying as Jesus approached, "Behold, the Lamb of God." So what a powerful time that must have been to see Jesus walking. But let's stay with Mary, and we're going to look at her gift of surrender. So I figured Mary gave many things, but one of the biggest things I think she did or gave was her surrender. She gave up so much. And I think in the hustle and bustle of our Christmas season, and we look at our nativity scenes, everywhere every church has one, every house has one or more. We look at that scene and we just look at the end result. But that journey to that point was pretty amazing. And I'd like to take some time and look at that. Because it definitely was a gift of surrender. If you just look up the word surrender, it simply means to cease resistance, to abandon oneself entirely, to agree to stop fighting, hiding, resisting. It's a relinquishing of power, if you will. And Mary definitely gave up everything she had going. Now, she was a very young lady, really a child. And how powerful the weight must have been when she realized that she was going to be with child and not be married to Joseph. She was betrothed, and she was set to be married. And for her to become pregnant meant, in people outside her circle, that she must have been with a man, had been unfaithful, and the Jews had a very dim look on that. Today we see that happen quite frequently, and it's not held with as much scrutiny. But back then it was a disgrace, a penalty, or a sin that was punishable by death. And even in Deuteronomy it talks about how the townspeople were to take the people to the edge of the city and literally stone them. So here's Mary finding out that she's going to be with child by the Holy Spirit, with the angel standing before her, telling her not to be afraid, and going to test the limits of faith in from Mary's perspective. Just the power of that one moment that Mary, maybe it didn't even occur to her until after the angel left, but she definitely was willing, because she listened to the message. She didn't doubt it. Maybe that's a lesson for us right there, that faith is a little child. She was very young. She hadn't learned how to be maybe a little more doubtful in God's word. Seems like the older we get, the more cynical we can get. And we tend not to believe everything at its face value. But Mary had the option to believe or doubt, but she believed. And she didn't want to miss out on that. But by doing that, by taking on what the angel said, she was surrendering a lot. Mainly her respect. She lived in the small town of Nazareth. She lived in a way that very close-knit community. Probably there was a fair amount of people in that community that were family. Someone was related to somebody. Just a little hamlet nestled in the hills. A lot of the homes, I understand, probably were caves, just small dwellings. And for her to say, for her to be willing to take on that shame, that reproach that would have been extended to her through the just through the message of the angel, the fact that she was going to bear the Messiah, but she had been with no man. She didn't understand how that was going to work, but apparently she was able to take it on faith. So, with that said, let's go ahead and take a look at Matthew 1, verses 18 through 24. We've touched on this chapter and this passage a few times through this series, but I'd like to read it again. And it said, this is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant with the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had a mind to divorce her quietly. And I like how the verse in the New King James reads. But while he thought about, this is verse 20, but while he thought about these things, he was musing over it. He wasn't just flying off the handle and just becoming, how could she do this to me? We were betrothed, and there was no, apparently he loved her. If he didn't love her, he wouldn't even thought twice about it, right? I mean, he was within his rights to have her stoned to death, and yet he didn't. He had compassion. And I think that really speaks of his love for her. But after he considered these things, back into chapter or verse 20, but after he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, because she was because what is conceived in her was from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you will give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. And all this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which translated means God with us. Now when Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord commanded him, and he took Mary as his wife. So even though Mary was surrendering, it's very obvious that Joseph did too. Joseph was laying on the line, and Pastor Craig brought this out last week, everything that he was. His business was riding on it, the public scrutiny, the shame, everything that would have been part of what he would have been trying to do would have been held up in scrutiny. Either one, he was a fool for marrying someone that had somebody else's child, or the fact that he might have been unfaithful and got ahead of the marriage. Either way, the scrutiny would have been terrible. So they both sacrificed respect. Her family. She sacrificed her family. The love and the comfort of a family in the time of a woman giving birth is amazing. We were fortunate enough to be close to my sister. We had several close friends. So when my wife became pregnant with our first child, there was already a network in place, and she could rely on that. That brought peace to her mind. That's a powerful thing. And then to have that literally in a moment, that's all going to be gone. She's not going to have any support whatsoever. She will not understand or have the privilege of people checking in on her, bringing her a meal, helping her maybe nest as she gets ready for the baby. All that's going to be gone. And so she literally sacrificed that. Her safety. Mary sacrificed her safety as well. She wasn't going to have the comforts of home. She was going to embark on a treacherous journey. There's an awful lot to go that's to be said for being close to the hospital. We know that we're going to just drive down the road. My full experience of participating in my daughter's birth was driving the car to the hospital. It took maybe 5 minutes. And the worst part of the journey was going over the Third Street Bridge that held the dips, right? Mary was 9 months pregnant, probably close to the end, and she saddled up on a donkey and traveled some 90 miles. That's devotion, and that's sacrifice. I can't even begin to imagine that. Let's talk about that comfort, the long trip that she was going to embark on. That's something, again, we don't even have a concept of. My trip to have to get my wife to the hospital, where there were doctors and nurses waiting in case anything went wrong. This woman, she traveled some 90 miles. I mean, if you were to be 9 months pregnant and decide you're going to go on a 90-mile trip, you're going to saddle up a donkey and you're going to walk to the Dalles, walk to Eugene. And it wasn't just a paved road. At least we'd have paved roads to walk on, clear path. These people were walking on trails and I'm sure they didn't have the National Forest Service, the BLM, taking care of the trails and managing those, getting those trees out of the way that might have fallen in a storm, or maybe there's a rock slide or two, because the journey itself would have started off through the flatlands, going through the deserts of the Jordan River, by the Jordan River. It says here, west over the hills surrounding Jerusalem and on to Bethlehem. So they're literally going into treacherous territory. Literally, lions and tigers and bears. I mean, they're literally going to be at the mercy of nature, not to mention the weather element. If this was at wintertime, which many people think, it may not have been. But at any rate, the temperatures would have been in the 30s, possibly. At night, definitely at or below freezing. And all this while you're pregnant. There wasn't a Howard Johnson's along the way or a Motel 6, no place to stay. There were spots and areas where they could stop and gather water. But they had to take enough water for the trip. They had to take enough bread for the trip. And it's not like they had, convenience stores to stop in if they ran a little low. They had to take what they were going to have. So here they are, enduring the threats of winter weather, heavy rains if possible. It can be quite treacherous. Those dirt trails and hilly roads would become muddy thoroughfares, just rivers. And here they had to take their care walking through that. At best, an average person probably would manage maybe 20 miles a day. Mary and Joseph, it's thought that they were maybe lucky to get 10. So this journey to Bethlehem probably took at least a week or more. And enduring the difficulties of pregnancy, trying to keep, Joseph had his hands full trying to keep her comfortable as possible, yet make his way to Bethlehem. Just as a father, that just boggles my mind. Again, I took 5 minutes and drove my wife to the hospital. It just blows my mind. And then, not to forget, completely be without, there was also probably the threat of bandits. They're in the wilderness. And people tended not to make this journey alone. They would band together in caravans or stuff, so maybe they were part of something like that. But still, this is a real threat. I mean, you're exposing yourself. You no longer have the safety and protection of your home. You are now out in the elements and subject to anyone that would come and want to do harm to you. But that didn't deter them. And that's to say something that I'm sure God extended the protection over them as they traveled. But they obviously had the faith. They were going to do this. My heart really goes to Joseph, the fact that he didn't just hold his wife in disdain, but he believed in her. And especially hearing the testimony of the angel, that obviously gave him the ability to stand tall in that. But I'm sure there was doubts before that. And the fact that he didn't act brashly and was just quick about it speaks much to his character. So they travel, and they make this journey, the unlikeliness of them getting there in any kind of record time. They had to definitely take their time and make sure that they got there safely. And when they arrived into the city of Bethlehem, obviously our story of the nativity involves, the hustling bustling of Bethlehem. It's not likely that they were full of inns and hotels and everything like that, but I'm sure there were places they were seeking somewhere to have this child. And the Bible talks about how there was no room, so they made their way into a stable. The stable could have likely have just been another cave, just a shelter for the animals. Likely the donkeys from the travelers would store their animals there, maybe some sheep. There's no telling. But I can speak to the condition of any stable. I don't know how many of you have ever shoveled out a stall for horses or tended cows. I've had friends that don't own a dairy farm. That is not a nice smell. That will stretch you. I remember being friends with two people moving to this to the town of Morton, Washington, and they were actually two brothers, very, very nice. And I remember them saying, hey, you want to come over after school? And it's like, yeah, that'd be great. And I did, and their dad had a dairy farm, and oh boy, you really had to get over that smell. But they had a pool table, they had all kinds of cool things, but I never even thought twice about it. And then when I was leaving, they really thanked me for coming. And I was like, oh, you're welcome. But they were just like, yeah, nobody ever comes out to our house. And I said, really? It's like, well, they don't like the smell. And it's like, it's not that big a deal. I mean, these are really neat guys. So we had a great time playing together. But I never thought, I never forgot about that. You know, that smell kind of hangs with you. But I've shoveled out a stall or two in my time, and it's not pretty. And to think that Joseph and Mary, this is where they're going to birth their son, the Messiah, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, into this stable. I just, it's hard to wrap my mind around that feeling. And thinking about all that Mary gave up, all that she surrendered, all that peace, all that safety, the respect, all of that, she just let it go. Because the task before her was much more than that. I mean, she honestly, she would have had a recollection of who the Messiah would have. There was prophecy, there was the Torah, you know. I'm sure she knew of what the Messiah was supposed to bring. And yet, she was willing to sacrifice all that because it was a far greater good than anything that any trivialness of her comfort would stand. She would have no reason to want to even think twice about it, if you will. And she obviously didn't. Very powerful, very powerful. So I imagine there was some time spent cleaning the stable area. I could see, I like the way the Chosen depicted it. Joseph focused on preparing a bed for Mary, and Mary said she was going to focus on preparing a bed for Jesus. And she selected the manger, which was a natural spot, closed area, much like a cradle. I'm sure there was a matter of cleaning and filling. They must have scrounged for some hay, hopefully, you know, clean, fresh hay, making an area for the baby and getting ready for that moment. My mind just goes beyond how people have been having babies ever since man was born. So it's obviously a pretty natural thing. We're so accustomed to having our hospitals and our doctors and our nurses and our midwives and our doulas to help us with these things. We don't read of Joseph having any help. He may have had help, but regardless, it still was done under unreasonable circumstances for the average person. Just the sake of clean linens is such a blessing when you're in a situation like that. And oddly enough, we never read of Mary complaining. I don't doubt that she had those thoughts. I think we all have doubts and concerns whenever we're in the midst of doing what God has called us to do, or the work is rarely easy, most often hard and difficult. But there's a peace that we can enjoy that God gives us, I think, to endure. It becomes a labor of love and no longer just a chore. Mary's work to birth the child, the Son of God, was worth it. It was a labor of love, and it was going to bring peace to all mankind. It's just so powerful. I was also struck by the sacrifices that Mary made. Isn't it interesting that we see Jesus, the apple doesn't fall too far from the tree. I imagine Jesus might have been encouraged by the stories of his mother and his birth when he was walking up the hill to Calvary, when there was going to be nothing to stop Jesus from getting to that cross. There was nothing that was going to stop Mary from having this baby. I don't think she was going to give up. And she was trusting that God would provide either the ability or the way, and also the means, the place to have this child. They must have had an incredible faith, or they probably would have gone crazy. They had to just believe God is going to provide, is going to hold off the pregnancy long enough to arrive and get settled and have this child. So I appreciate the power that Mary and Joseph just exhibited, shown that they had the ability to endure and not fall back. And like the song that we were able to sing, George and the worship team brought a lovely rendition of it. It's very powerful. Mary, did you know? There's so much in that. Just the heart of Mary. How could she know? How could she gather in all the things that the Messiah was going to be? She obviously knew about it. But I know when I was talking with my wife, when she's ready and in the midst of having that baby, there is nothing that she's worried about. She's not thinking about time. She's not thinking about, you know, what I look like. She doesn't think about who's going to be at the house. She is focused on birthing this child, and there is nothing on her mind. And I can only imagine that Mary was not any different. And when she held that baby for the first time, I don't think she was necessarily, at least at first, thinking of the Messiah, that he was going to save the world. I just put in my notes some phrases from the song. At the very moment that Jesus was born and she held her for the first time, just like the song says, did Mary know that child would someday walk on water? That he would save our sons and daughters? Mary, did you know that your baby's going to give sight to the blind? He's going to raise people from the dead. Do you realize, Mary, that when you kiss that little baby, you're kissing the face of God? That's so powerful. That's so amazing. The gravity of that situation. And then as she moved past that, maybe that all came rushing back to her. Maybe she realized at that moment, the child that she was holding truly is the great I am. This is the moment. Just let that sink in for a minute. She held the Son of God. Mary's greatest gift, I think, is surrender. And of course, the greatest Christmas gift we have is Jesus, for he did die for our sins and became the Savior of the world. He's the one that bridged that gap between sinful man and redeemed. And Jesus would go on to know this story. And I can't help but think that maybe it gave him courage to press on while he was enduring the trial. So like Mary, what are we willing to surrender this Christmas? Can have the worship team go ahead and come back. I know that that's a big ask, because there's a lot of things that happen with the Christmas season. There's so much going on, so much family, so much busyness. But I would hope that we could find in ourselves the answer to that question. What are we willing to surrender this Christmas? What could we surrender the day after Christmas? Christmas is a celebration of a certain point in time, but I know our family often talks about, you know, when we reach out and help families, it doesn't have to be just at Christmas time. It could be 365 days a year.
Consider something here. Heard a message this last week, and it talks about how God has no competitors. There's nobody that can compete with him. He's not competitive because he's everything. And because of that, when he manifests himself, the thing that he manifests himself in is not consumed. And you think about the burning bush. How is it that that bush that was on fire wasn't consumed? Because God is in competition with anybody. And think about the God of heaven inhabiting man, and the man not being overwhelmed. And that's Jesus. And then he said, I'm going to send the Comforter come to you. And we have that same spirit inside of us, and not being overwhelmed, but being gently led to do the things we need to do. And that's just, I'm so grateful for that. Let's just sing this last song. We sang it a little earlier. And just let this be a blessing to the Father.
Alleluia.
Earth and became a human. May we just focus on our hearts that we can be a blessing to our families this week, and then come back together and just celebrate the birth of the King. Thank you for being here, Lord. Just thank you for your goodness. We give you the praise. Everybody said, amen. Go make a difference in the kingdom this week. God bless you.